I'm a true believer. This is the room where we made Sweet Dreams originally. It's now become a very plush, expensive reception room, which is very exciting. But as you can see, it's not really very big. You can follow me from here to here. And from here to here. And this room was the very first room that we had in the church. And we rented it out. I think we paid about £9 a week for it. And we put all our equipment in here. And we made Sweet Dreams, but it didn't look like this. It had cobwebs over there, cracks down the wall, lots of damp, but lots of atmosphere. And this is the church when it was, I think, when it was originally built. And it doesn't look too much different today, except there's lots of music being played in it. This room is now, looks like this. When we first saw this room, it looked completely different because the two men that owned the church, they're called Bob and John, and they were puppet animators. And this room was where they used to do all their animation for their puppets. So there used to be sets for Cabberwick Green and little puppets and sort of railway tracks and stuff. Bizarre, very, very strange. Do not open this door. Alarmed. God, this used to be all rubble. Shower room. Ah, this is the Lulu. You can see Lulu. This is a wonderful machine. Ta-da! Big desks. Lots of tracks. Millions of tracks. I don't know how to operate these things, fortunately. Designer sitting room. It's a painting by Eric Scott. I wonder who those people are. This is the kitchen. Now, you really have to focus in on this wonderful new world gas range. Note, it is not an agar. So what do you think? And this is where I sit and I meditate before I get into the mood for singing songs. Money's the heft of broken twine. Should he never come back again? Will he not come back again? Will he not come back again? Better be. Will he not come back? Yeah, this is my harmonium. But I'm not really so religious. Huh? This was shipped all the way from Aberdeen when I was about 18. This is what I used to write songs on when I decided that that was what I wanted to do as a, well, career, whatever you want to call it. And when I met Dave, this is what I was writing songs on. And it's now in the church in Crouch End. And it's found its place because it's a real Victorian organ and it's a real Victorian church.
So did you used to go to church when you were young?
No, I'm an atheist. Completely. I mean, I used to sometimes be taken to Sunday school and church, but I don't have any religious beliefs anymore. And I certainly didn't then. I think my parents just needed the excuse to get me out of the house, you know. I longed to leave home and I wanted to come to London. I thought London held all the possibilities for all of the dreams that I had when I was...
The streets were paved with gold.
Well, not gold, but a chance to do something that I thought would mean a more interesting life. You know, I felt that life was very grey and dull where I came from. And I thought that at least in London I would meet artistic people. I had this... rather cliched concepts about artists. I thought all artists must be very interesting and very stimulating, and that if I went to music school it would all be wonderful. And it was quite a disappointment. So that there was a struggle after that because I really didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. And I think that many people of 17 or 18 or even older have this terrible, difficult struggle then, because they have to make big decisions about where they're going at such a young age when you haven't really had a chance to explore life. And so it was hard, yeah, it was pretty tough. And I was a bit lonely and I didn't find the people that I thought existed in London. That was very difficult, and I think it still is. It can be a very lonely city.
Inherited some of the ideals of your parents in terms when you're talking of wanting, you know, sort of some imaginary bohemian lifestyle.
I'm a curious contradiction of the two. I seem to be split right down the middle. Part of me is a complete, I don't know, I'm kind of anti-establishment in a way. You know, I have a very strong rebellious nature and something in me that kicks against the grain and can't conform to anything in particular. And yet, on the other hand, I have this driven puritanical streak, there's no question about that, which has probably helped me out, and probably, I think if I hadn't had it, I may have been much more destructive with myself than I have been. Now there's a lifestyle with fashion chic. The common concept of success is to have lots of hit records. But people really don't understand that there's a lot more to it than that. And that if you're not very careful, your whole personality and all of your activities can be consumed so much that you can have a very bad time. And everybody's seen it. Everybody's read all the gossip about people that have gone down either through drink or drugs or whatever. So I think success is always a very personal thing. Now there's a lifestyle. Everybody in it wants to be elite. And I said, walk here with your brand new shoes. So for me, I think it's a strange thing to say it, but although fame has some liabilities in the sense that one's private life can be really intruded upon and things like this, and it's kind of an intensive existence. On the other hand, I don't want it any other way because I don't have to explain to anybody so much who I am anymore. I think people appreciate that I make music and I sing, and that's my form of expression. And it's been a fantastic opportunity to get to that position where I can now make records. It's not so difficult to make records anymore. Before, it was a vague dream. It was just a notion, and I didn't know how people did it. And I can sing and just do the things that I want to do without having to compromise myself and without feeling that anybody is exploiting me. Well, it's something that's completely out of the normal everyday experience. And unless somebody has performed themselves, they really don't know what it feels like. But I'm not one of these very calm performers. I mean, I don't feel totally relaxed before I go on stage. I'm usually very charged and very concentrated on what I'm just about to do. And sometimes I'm very, very nervous, you know, because it's just a strange thing to do, just to have a lot of thousands of people's attention focused on you. So what I usually do, because I'm quite shy actually, is to deflect some of that attention, is to just immerse myself in the songs that I'm singing and I'm performing. And it's a total, it's quite a intense experience really, because there's a mixture of dread and fear and excitement, also some anxiety as to whether one's voice will give out or what, you know. If I'm feeling very strong in my voice, I can just feel so elevated because I know that I'm going to be capable of giving a good performance that night.
You obviously work with Dave Stewart. How does that working relationship, how would you describe it? You say it's a facet of yourself, but it's so closely bound up to somebody else's personality, that is it totally different?
Well, the thing with Dave and I is that even if we have personal differences and our you know, our lifestyles or whatever, our characters are different, when it comes to doing work in the studio, to being creative, for some reason, it works incredibly well. And I don't have to explain to him in too much detail a certain idea that I might have. And he doesn't really have to explain to me. So the thought processes are very fast. And it's almost like, you know, we've worked together for 10 years now, and it's become a very sophisticated process. And I just feel as if I don't have to explain myself to him anymore. Which is great, you know, because most of the time when you're not very confident, you know, you play an idea to somebody and you're so afraid that they're not going to like it, and you sort of think it's not very good anyway. But when I play something to Dave, no matter what kind of doubts I might have about it, he can always give me the kind of feedback that I really need to develop that idea and take it further. Whereas if I just work on my own, I don't have that catalyst, I don't have that feedback, and I think I work like that for him.
Do you love him?
Don't ask me questions like that. That's just too hippie-ish.
hair.
Where the people used to come in to go to church. Takes you back. Where we started. I'm off to do some work now. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.